This is the Kratom Science Podcast. I'm your host, Brian Gallagher, blog and social media writer for KratomScience.com, your source for all things Kratom.
My guest is Dr. Kirsten Smith. Her PhD is in social work, and she's currently doing postdoctoral work at National Institute on Drug Abuse. She's worked with communities with substance use disorder and was instrumental in introducing Kratom research to NIDA's intramural research program. Well, thanks so much for doing this. I really appreciate it, and I've been looking at your research and reading it, and we actually do a segment of the podcast called the Journal Club. I do it with Dr. John Cachet. We looked at the non-prescribed buprenorphine use mediates the relationship between heroin and Kratom study.
I actually listened to that on the way home from work last Friday.
Awesome.
Not the whole thing. And I'm going to scold you on something, but I'll wait till the end. I was talking to my car or to my stereo as I was listening to it. It actually has nothing to do with Kratom. It was about Appalachia. It's like, because I'm from Tennessee, and then I lived in Kentucky for several years doing my graduate work. And so I grew up technically in Appalachia, but in a college town in Knoxville, so it was like not rural. And then in Kentucky, like there's the Appalachian portion of Kentucky and Eastern Kentucky, and then everything, even Lexington's technically not in Appalachia, which, you know, so long story short, half of the people were from Appalachia, and then others were not.
Yeah.
But I'll just say, if you go down there and tell someone that they're in or not in Appalachia, you'll get a strong reaction depending on if you get it right or not. So it has nothing to do with Kratom. but I enjoyed listening to the to you guys, you know, going back and forth. It was nice.
But I'll just start at the beginning here. So you work at National Institutes on Drug Abuse. It's the Intramural Research Program in Baltimore. So can you tell the listeners a little bit about that program and what you do there?
Yeah, that's a good question. And so I should say, so it's really wonky and a lot, and I apologize, but a lot of things are wonky in science, and especially in explaining how NIDA sometimes works, or in the National Institutes of Health. So I'm actually what's called a fellow. There's a fancy title. It's postdoctoral training award fellow. And so what that means is that I'm not an actual government employee, but what we do is, you know, once you get a PhD, or even we have for bachelor's graduates who come and do like a postdoc, I'm what's called a postdoc doing my postdoc. So it's kind of like a rotation. So, you know, after you get a PhD, you go to a certain place and do a postdoc for anywhere from 1 to 5 years or more. And at NIDA, the typical postdoc rotation is 3 to 5 years. So what I'm doing is kind of being a visitor at NIDA to get really good training before I go on to a university. So I've been at NIDA's intramural research program for 2 years this August, and I'll be staying probably about 2 more years before going to a university to continue the work that I'm doing now. And so I think something that's helpful for people to understand, because even it's just weird. So there's what's NIDA does a lot of funding that's extramural. So people apply for grants at universities, and then NIDA decides, okay, what is scientifically worthy? And they send that money out to universities. And so the intramural program is actually really cool because we get to kind of play with our toys in-house instead of having to, you know, send money out to universities. So we're actually allowed, and I shouldn't say we, because I am, again, a postdoc, so I'm not a principal investigator. Even though I am a scientist and a researcher, I'm kind of still under my mentor, Dr. David Epstein. All of the principal investigators get to set agendas that are in keeping with NIDA's broader strategic mission, and design some really, really cutting edge work that is really hard to do and, or hard to get necessarily funding or approval for at other places. So I'm really proud to be at NIDA IRP. And the group that I work with is the Real World Assessment, Prediction, and Treatment Unit. And we're a small lab, and we do a lot of work in the field, like ambulatory assessments. It's called ecological momentary assessment. And I'll actually talk about that later, maybe, because one of our upcoming Kratom studies is going to be using that. And I know it sounds like a mouthful, and it's like really fancy sounding, but it's pretty simple when you explain it. It might actually be easier if I tell you how I kind of brought Kratom to NIDA, because there's kind of a story. There's kind of this, like, my Kratom journey has been a weird one, as I'm sure many people's Kratom journeys are. Would you like me to talk about that?
Please. Yeah. That sounds really interesting.
Yeah. I mean, because to be honest, I did not, when I first encountered someone using Kratom in a clinical setting, when I was doing basically what's called like an internship or a rotation in a substance abuse treatment facility in Kentucky. And it was the first time I heard about Kratom was actually in like 2015. It was 2015. And a client was using it. And this was when the synthetics were really taking off. And I was like, is this like the crocodile thing? Is this not a cathinone or a cannabinoid? What are you, I was like, what? I basically was like, what on earth is this? Although I used stronger languages than that. But and really it was, I tell this story because it stuck with me for two reasons. One, the client reported, that he had, of course, prescription opioid dependence and substance use disorder. And he was taking it. He was like, it's a tea from Vietnam. And I'm like, okay, what is that? And he was like, not entirely sure what he was even taking, which I think is a huge part of the Kratom story more broadly.
Yeah.
And he described, not feeling like he was really high, but that his opioid craving was, diminished and his anxiety was decreased. And that, I'm like, so it doesn't get you high. And he's like, I mean, I don't think so. And I'm like, I kind of was like, okay, well, who cares? I kind of just didn't even realize the significance of what he said until I met more and more people. And the reason I remember him, and this is not the first time I've told this story, because I will talk about it when I give talks sometimes. He ended up getting discharged from the program along with another client who's using it because there were no drug tests. People didn't understand what it was. And we still are. I'm still very humble. We all are humble and learning continually about this plant, which is very complex. And he got discharged because it was an abstinence-only program, and tried to do some 12-step stuff, and then ended up using heroin because it was right when heroin was beginning to proliferate in areas that it was not previously really widespread. And then he ended up dying of a heroin overdose after just trying to be purely abstinent. The entity, that shall remain nameless, did not believe in like buprenorphine or kratom or anything that was an abstinence. So, knowing that the first person I know that used kratom ended up dying because of a really not great treatment system that he had access to, just kept it in the back of my mind, and I couldn't, so I kept increasingly hearing about it, like at the like street level, right? So I kind of liken myself as like a gonzo researcher, which is maybe not something that I should brag about, but I really do try to stay attuned to like what real people in real world settings are doing, and not just like be in some ivory tower. So it's been by virtue of that I've been able to keep up with, how are people using Kratom? And so the initial exposure in that way actually led to that 2017 survey that you had highlighted in your journal club. That was the second paper. There was only two papers that came out of it related to Kratom. Mm-hmm. And that was the second one. So It was early on that I started to care about it. And I kept thinking, all right, well, that's great. Kratom's wonderful, but I mean, not wonderful as in I'm endorsing or anything, but as in it's an interesting research subject, I should say that. So Kratom's this very interesting thing, but I don't have time for it. I have this other career geared at more like social science stuff. But I kept like, no, you can't, once you kind of are intrigued by it, you can't stop. And I think in terms of researching or wanting to research it, because it's so complex on every level, and we know so little still. That, and there's just so much work to be done, that people like myself, and Oliver Grundman is another example, you know, we kind of did not anticipate that our lives would be and our careers would be so centered on Kratom. But, you know, once you kind of get down this road, it's really compelling, really interesting stuff. And so I came to NIDA and told, you know, Dr. David Epstein, my mentor, who is a very, very smart, very well-respected scientist, and he had no idea what Kratom was. And I explained it and talked about, you know, it's a partial biased, seemingly biased agonist. And that's a whole other loaded kind of thing, the term biased in terms of science. There's like a debate about if it's a thing or if it's not a thing. But I explained the pharmacology the best we understand it. And he's like completely flabbergasted. And he's like, and you can buy it at a gas station? I'm like, yes, and you can buy it at a gas station. And so now he is intrigued by it. And I've kind of indoctrinated him into the Kratom cult, like research cult, that is. And he'll be the first one to admit that. So we've done a lot of surveys recently and some social media text analyses. And we are gearing up. We're going to be using that formative data to inform what will be a really nice departure from, and I shouldn't say departure, the survey work needs to continue, but we're going to be doing some more rigorous studies in the coming months. And so I'm happy to talk about some of the work we've done so far and where we're going, but I leave that to you.
Can I just ask a little bit about your background? Do you mind?
Yes. Okay. I know what I can and should not pivot to. So, by all means.
Okay. So on your Twitter bio, it says you're a former heroin user, and there was also a study that you recently did, or it might have been a letter. I just saw the abstract, but it was about potential value of the insights and lived experiences of addiction researchers with addiction. And two quotes I want to read is, those with research expertise in addiction rarely speak freely about these overlapping perspectives, and you wanted to explore the possibility that their expertise may help advance addiction science while helping to reduce stigma. So why did you choose to put that out there publicly about yourself on your Twitter bio about being a former heroin user?
Yeah, I think so. I actually wondered if that would come up just because it recently there's been a lot of hubbub on Twitter with myself and my co-authors. And when I say hubbub, I mean in a good way. The commentary that you noted just now, we actually had a scientific meeting called the College on Problems of Drug Dependence, which is it's a big scientific annual conference, so to speak, and it's been going on for like 80 years. It's a big deal. And so we had a forum actually at that conference with a few other people who weren't on the commentary, including the people on the commentary. So it was a nice, well-rounded discussion, and it generated a lot of buzz as well. And so I'm frankly still reeling a little bit from the commentary being published and from that even more direct verbal, you know, forum disclosure. And to answer your question, the reason that I decided to do that is because, you know, it's something that I have to dance around, and not necessarily around people who I work with directly, but in terms of people I don't know as well, you know, it's something that could come up, but there's this balancing act. And I even said this during the forum of, you know, I don't want to disclose my past like, and it was more than just hair. I mean, I used other substances. This is not like a secret at this point. It's not a secret. Even though heroin and prescription opioids were my preferred drugs, you know, it's this kind of balancing act of not wanting to be weird and just going around and telling everyone, hi, by the way, my name is Kirsten and I used to inject heroin. Like, that's not what I want to put on my CV and lead with, right? Yeah. And the other, you know, the problem is that on in clinical settings like peer led recovery or things like that, my past could be an asset, but in academia or research, it could be considered a liability. Well, I think the zeitgeist, you know, currently of diversity and inclusion made the timing right. Mm-hmm. And also my mentor, Dr. Epstein is very supportive of, you know, well, I mean, data from or information from whatever source you can get it. So, you know, while you can't take your, you know, I couldn't take my past experience and say, build a theory around it, but I could falsify certain claims based on knowing what I know or have seen what I've seen. And likewise with preclinical work, such as animal models, you know, preclinical researchers with an addiction history have the capacity to also, you know, improve how we go about making those animal models. You know, and even talking about things like craving or drug-related cues, there's a lot of jargon that's still debated, you know, amongst researchers about what are we measuring and how are we measuring it. So mm-hmm. I think from a scientific perspective, there is value in people like myself disclosing. And I have to say that I have heard from many people since that paper and forum recently, and, you know, we're not... You know, we're a minority, but there's a lot more of us than I, you know, might think. So I think, like the paper said, the other part was just to kind of help diminish the stigma, right? We have millions of people in the United States with a history of opioid use disorder, and those are just opioids. So, you know, to think that we're not going to have people with substance use disorders in professional you know, positions and in scientific positions is just improbable given the sheer number of people who've had a substance use disorder history. So long story short, I think that the moment had finally come to be more public and advocacy oriented. And I have to say that NIDA has been extremely supportive at, you know, multiple levels, which is extremely gratifying and encouraging in and of itself. So
seeing a couple like you yourself and Carl Hart is another one just come out and say that I, you know, used to use drugs is probably a pretty positive thing. Is that what made you want to get into social work in the first place?
Yeah, actually. Mm-hmm. To your first point, say one thing that I think is worth noting for your audience, which is that there is a movement, whether it's psychedelic researchers or psychonauts who, you know, document a lot of their use, or people who use in moderation but have controlled use. I think that there is going to continue to be this kind of growing push towards transparency and openness, given the war on drugs and, you know, given the fact that you can only, I don't know, you can only hide your personal life so much. I think there is going to be a trend away from, like hiding in the closet, so to speak,
yeah,
and being like what Carl Hart disclosed, which is pretty remarkable. So, yeah. I mean, yeah. So as far as my background, I really intentionally was just going to quote unquote help people. I finally stopped, you know, using, kind of, you know, got my act together with a lot of support from my family and great people. And, I didn't really know what I was going to do. I never thought I would actually end up in research. I just submitted a grant, and in the grant application, I'm like, yeah, this is a very weird path I stumbled on too, because I never thought I'd be on it. But what happened was I wanted to help other people who had experienced substance use disorders. And then working in a treatment setting, I realized how broken the systems of care are, which is one reason why when people talk about using Kratom, because they are having issues with healthcare, and whether that's substance abuse treatment or chronic pain treatment, you know, I've seen that firsthand. So knowing that the systems, so to speak, and when I say systems, I mean like medical systems mainly, and systems of care, don't work for everyone or are not equitably accessible to everyone, I was like, you know, this is like putting band-aids on gunshot wounds. I need to figure out how the gun works and go another level further. And so that's when I decided to get a PhD and shift from any sort of clinical practice to research. And then even from social science, I'm doing a harder pivot to like behavioral pharmacology and more quote unquote hard science work in the coming years, simply because that's where the kratom research needs to go, is to controlled laboratory work. And I'm actually currently the lead investigator on a double randomized placebo controlled clinical trial for a biased opioid agonist that's in some ways kind of similar to kratom. Yeah. So yeah, it's been a strange journey to get here.
You touched on a little bit about healthcare access. People in Kentucky, they're in inpatient rehabilitation programs that you surveyed, and this was 2017, right, where those two studies came out of. There was a lot of discussion about how there's a lack of access to medicated assisted treatment programs in Kentucky, and especially in the Department of Corrections, I think there's none in there. How much is it a factor of like not having access to healthcare in that sample size or in general that people seek out maybe illicit drugs or diverted buprenorphine, where it's a prescribed drug, but they obtain it illicitly, or even kratom. How much is like a lack of healthcare a factor in which drugs that they choose?
So it's kind of mixed. So based on my experience and research, we don't have a one-to-one, we don't have any sort of self-report that explicitly states, well, because of my, treatment options, I'm using kratom. Now we do, we've collected data recently that speak to this. Both Reddit data were examined, and then also survey data that we've done at NIDA. And there's a couple of layers to this. So there's earlier work, which is mixed in when I say my work, but also Oliver Grunman's work and some other survey work, which again, there's only so much in the United States. We have a lot more work from Asia. That there are people with access to healthcare that are using kratom for, supplementing their medical care, right? So some people have great healthcare, great insurance, but are still using kratom substitute or supplement their prescription opioid regimen, which is licitly prescribed, like they're getting a prescription, but they don't necessarily like them, or they don't want to use as many pills, and so they'd rather take kratom. So that's a sub-portion of people that we can say at least those people are using kratom to self-treat certain things like chronic pain or, anxiety and depression and things like that. And they still have health insurance. For some people, it's they don't have health insurance, or again, we don't have enough data to make a solid, unequivocal claim here. So that's not what I'm doing. But just there are people who kind of fall through the cracks, so to speak. So they may have health care access or health insurance, but because the systems are burdened, and because there is, as you noted, a lot of limitations in buprenorphine prescribing. So buprenorphine is kind of like the life-saving opioid agonist therapy apart from methadone. And some people can't get access to that, or the stigma of doing it is such that they don't want to. And it would be, better for them just in their minds. And this again is what we're seeing with some of the Reddit data, to just go ahead and use kratom instead. One of the things that, is problematic is that substance use disorder treatment is very heterogeneous. I should say there's heterogeneity in the sense that you could walk into 12 different doors to 12 different treatment centers in America and get 12 different interventions, some of which are scientifically informed and evidence-based, some of which are less so, some of which might be predatory. If you have cancer, you can pretty much find an oncologist who's going to mostly say, yes, you have cancer, and this is what cancer you have, and here's how we're going to treat it. And there's going to be a lot less room for difference in terms of care. And that's not the case with substance use disorder. So I think that while I can't say that the earlier data directly imply that having insurance or not having insurance is related to kratom use, I think the one thing that is clear is that people are using kratom. I mean, this is the data are very clear on this. They are using kratom to self-treat many, many conditions, as I'm sure you and your listeners know. So it's a matter of, why use this to self-treat as opposed to something else? And that's what we're still in the process of trying to find out. And I'll say, at least in some of our preliminary analyses for some survey data that were recently collected, we do ask people, like, do you want to disclose your kratom use to a healthcare provider? Were you getting adequate treatment for your pain? Were you getting adequate treatment for your opioid use disorder or anxiety or et cetera? So even though it's not out yet, we will be putting out a paper that is an IDA-funded project that will directly answer your question. So it's just a matter of me getting it. I will say this, there are going to be many papers coming out in the next couple of months.
And this is from the 2019 study, which is the second one that came out. So it was like 10.2% of the whole sample reported past year kratom use, which I think it was like 49 people. One of his questions were, why wasn't fentanyl one of the substances examined in the study?
Yeah, so this is a great question. So when that study was, it was my first little survey study, when that was developed in 2016, fentanyl had not yet become a household name, okay, like it sadly is at this point. So I wish fentanyl had been on that. It's been added to our current surveys that we're doing. And I know Oliver's added it to some of his as well. So it's just the timing of it. Fentanyl took off, basically as those data were being collected. But yeah, I wish I had fentanyl on there as its own line item. The problem with that is a lot of people, once fentanyl was starting to be used, and this is a problem we still are encountering in terms of self-report work, is that a lot of times people don't know if they're using fentanyl. So it's hard to measure whether they've used it. So what we do now is ask heroin and then fentanyl separately. And then even sometimes, like, do you know if you used fentanyl? Because sadly, at this point, heroin and fentanyl are often interchangeable.
85% of the people surveyed had been incarcerated, and 25% were currently incarcerated. Is there an issue with they might be too afraid to answer the survey questions honestly?
So this is, I'm so glad you asked me this, because this is one of the things that I did when I listened to the that podcast. I'm glad you're giving me the opportunity to clarify. So first, I think it should stay past year incarceration. Some people, and I'm sadly don't have the paper in front of me. A lot of people in that sample would have been on probation. It was mostly people on probation or parole. The settings that they were in were technically Department of Corrections settings, but they were not in jail at that point, although the vast majority had at least been incarcerated at one point. So to answer your question directly, having worked with the University of Kentucky, this is something I did for several years, actually, was do research for someone else with people who were incarcerated, who had just been released from being incarcerated, or who were on probation or parole. And so this is a population that I know really, really well. And, it's some of the first kratom using people were also part of this population.
Yeah.
And I think to answer your question, for this survey and for a lot of other surveys, you would be surprised to know how honest most people are about self-report. So we have things in research. There's all these different biases that can come in. And those can include, obviously, not being truthful because you don't want to be in trouble. But oftentimes it's more like social desirability bias is what we call it. So people If they're answering a survey, might not want to say that they do X or Y because they, you know, don't want the person asking to think less of them. The good thing about that survey that I conducted is that it was entirely anonymous, and the informed consent preamble made it very clear that, you know, their data would not be used. Even if we wanted to link them to their data, we couldn't. There was literally no way of doing it. So sometimes there's like a personal identifier or a unique participant ID number. Even with this study, there was no such thing. So there was, and people didn't have to take it. So it was a voluntary survey. And I feel pretty confident in two things. One, the academic literature does support that substance using people and people who are involved with the criminal justice system don't necessarily have any lower rate of responding truthfully. And there are ways to kind of validate and verify if that's true or not, like using urine drug screens, or even these like validity checks within the same document. So there's that part of it. The other part of it is just where I pride myself, at least with that study, on being, you know, a good researcher and very transparent. So yeah. One thing that I continue to do at NIDA is something that I did there, which is A, tell people exactly what they're consenting to do. And yeah. B, when I, you noted it was, these were administered in like a large kind of cafeteria setting, getting up with, I'm covered in tattoos, by the way, and speaking directly to people like on their level and saying, listen, uh-huh. You know, here's the actual deal. And we can also give certificates of confidentiality and basically give people enough confidence to know that we are not going to be engaging in what's called research misconduct. So,
yeah.
You know, I feel that most people who do any sort of survey or participate in anything that I've done before NIDA or at NIDA, they know what they're getting into, and they have autonomy to decide for themselves if they want to participate. So.
And the other thing he was talking about was, it was in the conclusion, but it said the inability to readily access kratom due to prohibitions may increase willingness to seek professional OUD treatment. He had a problem with that, but then the rest of it said, yet as the high rates of blah, blah, blah indicate that people using, they may procure harm reduction medications illicitly and independently of formal medical channels. So he was wondering why you would, you know, the conclusion would bring that up as a possibility of kratom prohibition actually helping people, or was that just to kind of set up the rest of the argument?
What was my exact sentence, by the way? What did I even say?
Okay, here, I'll just read it. The inability to readily access kratom due to prohibitions may increase willingness to seek professional OUD treatment.
Yeah. So I remember what I said. So, okay. I mean, that's essentially one possibility.
Yeah.
I don't know that it's a likely possibility, but it is true that and many people would say, well, if you can't get this, you know, and you need to have another kind of opioid substitution or treatment or whatever, then maybe you will go and sign up for, you know, buprenorphine treatment if you can access it. Well, if that were the case, they might have already done that. So, I mean, it's kind of like you need to talk about all possibilities. We don't know what that counterfactual world would be for a given person. And it could be that for some, they might do that. Mm. It could be that for some, they might go back to heroin. It could be for some that they just stop doing everything and start doing yoga. I mean, there are like infinite possibilities of what could happen. But in terms of talking about kratom, especially early on, and, you know, in going through a peer review process, you know, it is important to say, you know, what the implications of prohibition might have been or might be. And I still think that that's something that, I'm not a policy person, I don't necessarily want to talk about policy, but it is something that is considered generally. If kratom was to be prohibited, what would people do? And I think that there's been enough publicly stated information from regular users at this point about how bad it would be. And at least I can speak to COVID-19 findings, some of which will be coming out soon, just about, you know, what do people do who use Kratom regularly if their supply is cut off, not necessarily due to prohibition, but due to a global pandemic. And it's a mixed story. So to answer your direct question, as far as why I put that there is, because I mean, I think it's important to talk about, you know, what is possible, you know, on both sides. And the answer to that is we don't know. I mean, yeah. And it would vary by person. That's the one thing I will say is it will vary by person.
This is something I talked about with Krundman, and I was actually I interviewed him last year, and I was just recently transcribing his interview, and then he mentioned your name, and I was like, the one thing he pointed out was you mentioned like one intravenous use, but what Grunman said, it doesn't look like people are trying to extract the main alkaloids from kratom and get it into their system faster through like snorting or injection, and that's kind of a sign. Is that a sign? And then also mentioned, I think one of your studies mentioned the same thing with buprenorphine. There's not a lot of converting that into injection IV.
Buprenorphine's a little bit easier, and so there are ways to do. So buprenorphine is a separate one, and it's something. Diverted buprenorphine is something I'm interested in as mm-hmm. well, and have another study on because it's just interesting, but. With respect to kratom, so yeah, I believe that there was one person in my sample that had tried to inject it, and maybe one or two that had tried to snort it because they did not know what they were doing yet, and they were going to at least try it, and they found out you couldn't really, especially with, you know, the powder and all that. So no, I mean, the routes of administration are almost all oral. Everything is converged on that being the route of administration. It's mm-hmm. just a matter of, you know, what type, you know, and at what dose. And that's about those are the questions that we're, I mean, now that we know, you know, what we're talking about, because at first everyone was just confused. What is kratom? What is kratom? Now that we know increasingly kind of what it is, you know, everything's converging on, you know, a few different kinds of, you know, types of preparations, and several different kinds of ways of dosing. But, you know, as far as the risk of, well, I mean, I don't know if you had a specific question other than if you're getting at risk.
Does it indicate that people were trying to use, even there's like a subset of diverted buprenorphine users that just use, I guess, the strips or whatever. And does it mean they're using it to self-treat rather than to get high, like to heal rather than to get high? Are they trying? Does it indicate that with kratom and some diverted buprenorphine that since they're not trying to get the strongest possible dose, that they're trying to heal from it?
Yeah. So for both, so going to kratom first, it's increasingly clear based on my research and the other literature that most people are taking it for very pragmatic reasons. This has been borne out in the survey literature, including work I've done, you know, with Hopkins. So Al Garcia Romeo and the Hopkins group, Marion Coe has another large survey. There are several like really large surveys that have come after Oliver Grunman's. And, you know, we're seeing that people are using it for very specific reasons, and that the majority of those reasons do not include trying to just get this euphoric high. That's, you know, that quote unquote high. That said, there are people who who do report using kratom to improve their mood, enhance, you know, energy, to, you know, feel a recreational euphoria. So it's not as though that's absent from the entire kratom using population, but we're talking about a very large and diverse group of people. And, you know, people can have more than one reason to do something. Mm-hmm. So people can, this is very clear from the work. People might report using it to reduce anxiety, but also to improve mood and energy and to feel good. I mean, some of the Reddit data that are going to be published very soon get at what some of the survey literature really couldn't get at least not at first, which is that, you know, most people are using it just to like be a better human. like the takeaway message is You know, I don't feel good. And whether it's because of pain or because I am socially anxious or because I have ADHD or because I want to, you know, be, you know, have like more stamina, or because I have chronic fatigue. I mean, there's so many, just so many different reasons, including I don't want to be on heroin anymore. I want to use this instead of heroin. That most people are not using it to achieve this kind of like high per se, more than just, I want to function. I want to live my daily life and go do what I need to do. And I think that buprenorphine, for some is the same. And we know from the diverted buprenorphine literature that most people who are using diverted buprenorphine are using it because they need treatment and they are not getting it, or because they're in withdrawal and they're trying to self-treat withdrawal. You know, the short version of the diverted buprenorphine story is really just a treatment gap. Like, we have people who are struggling to kind of, you know, manage their opioid use disorder, and they're not getting engaged with systems of care. And so they're using it either as a stopgap so they can kind of, you know, reset, or they're using it to try to get off of heroin. The one exception I would say, and this does get back to Appalachia, is that, you know, we have seen at least clinically, and I don't know how many case reports have documented this, you know, there are at least in some areas where, and this gets back to rural Appalachia, you know, prescription opioid prescribing has changed, and it's more, you know, more expensive to obtain illicit prescription opioids. And so some people are using diverted buprenorphine before they've ever even used any other opioid. That's the first opioid drug that they ever do, which is very interesting. And again, I would say that's a very, you know, it's a minority. But again, it shows that there's like this treatment gap of just getting people engaged with care. And likewise with kratom, it seems that a lot of people just want to be able to take kratom for a very specific reason and kind of go about their day. And I think you noted from the 2019 paper, you know, no one really, at least among that sample, and I should say that that small sample is somewhat different than the, you know, Oliver Grundman's sample or the subsequent large studies that, like the one I helped with Dr. Albert, you know, Garcia Romeo. You know, these were really, these are people who had been in treatment a lot. They were polydrug using adults who had a very extensive history. And to me, that makes them the best sample to ask this question of, you know, do you prefer kratom to other drugs? And the vast majority did not. And that is saying something. And it goes back to the first client that I met who was describing feeling better but not getting high. So I think that that's something that we need to keep in mind as we move forward and ask more questions, is just drilling down to greater specificity about what are you using for and why, and is it working?
And there's, it seems like there's kind of a moral implications in getting high versus treating something. But I mean, people have a couple of drinks as a social lubrication, but you could also call that self-treating for mild social anxiety. Do you see it like that? Like, it's kind of, I mean, like, recreational use is kind of a loaded word when people are using drugs for some reason.
Well, I mean, I don't have an opinion on it. I can only speak as a scientist and just say that it is a phenomenon that's existed since the dawn of man met psychoactive botanical number one back however eons ago. So we just know that this is what people do. I drink coffee every morning. And I think that what we're seeing with cannabis, kratom, a lot of other things is just that people, people are using for different reasons. And the one thing that we know for sure is that, you know, there's a really big difference between substance use, substance misuse, and addiction. And I think that we do our best work when we keep in mind that there is not just people who are addicted people who are trying to get high and misuse drugs, and people who are, I mean, you know, to your point, there's controlled use. And there's a lot of, you know, qualitative ethnographic work. Cocaine Changes is a really good book. Drug Set and Setting by Zinberg is a really good book that are, you know, that get at and document that people can use drugs like heroin or cocaine and then learn to moderate use or stop use or continue in some kind of pattern. I think kratom is no exception to that.
And I had a question about, like, what do you think causes addiction in the first place? You had a comment on...
That's a whole other podcast series. Oh, man. Sorry.
Yeah. I mean, you had a comment on Haley et al., the centrality of the brain and the fuzzy line of addiction. So my just basic question is, do you think addiction is like a brain disease? And if so, does that come all through genetics or does it happen through like conditioning, like childhood trauma?
So, yeah, and I apologize that I interrupted you, but the question you just asked me could be it's an own podcast series.
Yeah.
That we go, because there's a lot to say on that. And the very short, I'll go with the easy one first. Yes, we know that genetics play a role in in gravitating towards trying drugs or liking certain drugs more than others. But that's not saying much, right? So genes are involved in everything. So to say that genes are involved in this is kind of like, well, no kidding. So it gets back to probability, right? So increasingly what we'll be able to do, and I don't say me myself, but scientists will be able to, understand the human genome better and understand, what genetic factors are associated with increased likelihoods for certain outcomes, including drug use or addiction, right? So that has a lot to do with environment. So some genes are not even activated or they're not expressed unless certain environmental conditions occur. So the gene environment interaction is, of course, extremely complex, and childhood development and neurobiological development, particularly between in utero and say age 6 and then even age 14, has a lot to do with how people end up as adults. That said, people are dynamic, brains are dynamic. And as far as considering addiction a brain disease, or let's say, looking at it from a behavioral economics standpoint as more of this maladaptive learning or disorder of choice, which is instantiated in the brain, just like anything else, it's kind of a semantic thing. The easy and shorter answer to the question is to say that, there are two camps within addiction science, at least the people that care about this aspect of it, those that consider it to be a chronic brain disease and those that consider it to be this maladaptive kind of disorder of choice, for lack of a better term. And they're both pretty much overlapping and in agreement about most things, and they wouldn't disagree about most facts. So it's more of a framing and a theoretical orientation that would kind of drive one camp to be one way and one camp to be another way, even though they agree on like most things. I myself, I don't personally like the brain disease model as what I would choose to conceptualize addiction as, even though, again, I can't disagree with most things. So Marcus Heilig, who wrote that paper, I agree with the vast majority of what he said. It's just a few little things that are important points of departure that I still think that as a scientific discipline, we're having to reconcile and kind of come to terms with. But everything does happen in the brain, and so we can at least agree on that much. A longer answer to your question would take about a year, and I could talk for it about a year. So the short answer is just more of a, we need to take a more biopsychosocial model of addiction, because we are brains and environments at the end of the day. So,
is there actually more addiction in communities of poverty, or is it just because people in poverty have less access to medical care to treat their addiction? Maybe, you know, there's like a bigger risk of being having some kind of substance use disorder, or does the rural part play a factor? Because I look at a lot of I had Dr. Singh on here, and he was talking about how, you know, there's just not medical care in rural areas in Malaysia. Do those things have a direct effect on the risk of problem drug use or addiction?
The short answer is yes. So poverty is positively correlated with increased likelihood of using drugs and then developing substance use disorder. And a lot of that has to do with, there's a term you might want to look up. It's called social determinants of health. And we see this not just for substance use disorder, but for many, many health behaviors or just behaviors, as well as things like, you know, so people's weight or mental health or, you know, even, you know, increased likelihood for certain types of early morbidities. And, you know, a lot of it is associated with scarcity. So whether it's resource scarcity, it is in money or information or access to treatment or access to just knowledge in advance or just access to stable developmental environments that are enriched rather than impoverished in like a literal sense of the word of just not having enough stimulation during, you know, early childhood development. So there's a lot of factors that go into it. It's again, very complex, but we do see that people who are in harsh and resource poor conditions are, you know, or who have significant childhood trauma and stress, you know, do have a higher likelihood of using drugs and developing a substance use disorder, particularly if they start using before the age of, you know, 13 or 14. And, you know, so I think that it's a two-sided problem. One, it's an increased risk. And then also it's harder to get help, you know, if you're lower socioeconomic status after the fact. And I think that it could go, you know, we see this in both highly rural and highly urban areas. So mm-hmm. I would say the extremes of different types of, you know, living also kind of tie into the poverty narrative as well.
I guess you had talked about stuff that you're working on now or any research that you can talk about on Kratom specifically.
We're really excited that we have several studies. I mentioned a survey study. We used Amazon Mechanical Turk and had a large crowdsourced online survey study that was for a larger project. But, I put in Kratom questions. And then what we did was recontact and follow up with a subset of people who, you know, we could get a hold of, basically. And so now we have a really, really, really pristine data on Kratom from people who are not just regular users, but people who have also quit or decreased use or increased use. So we have it's a much more diverse sample than we've had before. And we're going to be using that to inform a lot of, or not a lot, but some of the next study that we're gearing up to do, which is going to be probably launching in the fall. And that is something I'm working on getting put together now. So basically we're going to, instead of doing a survey again, which again, we need to keep doing surveys, but we're going to do a national 2-week long study where we enroll people who regularly use Kratom. So basically 3 or more times per week. And then they will do what's called ecological and momentary assessment. And all that is a fancy way of saying that we want to take a little snapshots of data, self-reported. We're not going to be collecting like GPS or anything like that. Just self-reported data about, you know, how they're feeling at different times of day, when they're using Kratom, what they're feeling. And so we kind of triangulate, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of data points by sampling, you know, several hundred people, but across a 2-week period. So a person, instead of responding to what's called like a cross-sectional survey where they just do it one time, they'll be answering little mini questions at random times and, you know, over 2 weeks. And then we'll be analyzing Kratom product samples from those people. This is a partnership with the University of Florida and Johns Hopkins University. For a very small subset, we're going to have a few people come into NIDA, where I work, and then also provide us some biospecimens. We're going to get some urine and blood and analyze, you know, what the plasma looks like and what the metabolites are, you know, from them, and also get a sample of the Kratom product they're using. So
That's great.
In some ways a small study, but in other ways, it's a kind of big step forward to then doing more controlled laboratory-based work, which is what I plan to do next, which is actually bringing people in and putting them in controlled environments and monitoring different things based, you know, that we don't need to go down yet, but that will be kind of the next phase, is much more rigorous human work that will build to clinical trials, hopefully.
That's great. And I'm glad the actual Kratom is being sampled, because, I mean, just what we found, I mean, what people found, they say the greens do this, the reds do this. I had some from this other company that's completely different. And so I think it's going to help, because it has such a complex alkaloid profile that it hits so many different of the you know, brain receptors, that I think it's going to help a lot to get an actual what they're actually taking and then what's going on with them. And I can't wait to see that one. That's going to be awesome. That'll probably take a while, huh?
Well, actually, no, I mean, it depends. We're hoping that recruitment, you know, it's really the participation in the study is probably about 15 days total. And so, and people can do it from their smartphone, so they don't have to come in and do it. So it actually might, I mean, well, I should say that your sense of time and my sense of time might be different. So, because science moves very slowly, you know, we expect that data collection should not take more than a year to complete. And given the American Kratom Association and some vendors are going to be helping, once we have IRB approved study recruiting materials, we'll be putting those out. I might bug you as well and have you put some out. Once the IRB is approved, all of our recruiting methods, we're actually not sure if we should expect like a deluge of, like, you know, way too many people all at once wanting to do the study, or if it's going to take longer. It is a compensated study. We do pay people to participate in this because it is more rigorous than a survey. So we're not sure what to expect with that, but we do know that a lot of people who use Kratom have been very happy to do research in the past. So we are hoping that we'll have good recruitment.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kirsten Smith. Please like, subscribe, share, rate, review, and check us out on Twitter at Kratom Science. We'll be posting Dr. Smith's upcoming studies along with any other Kratom study. The music is Risey. The song is Memories of Thailand. The Kratom Science Podcast is written and produced by me, Brian Gallagher, for KratomScience.com. Take care.